Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Creation of My Facade presentation, Jesus explains how the choice to refuse to feel terror and to be emotionally overwhelmed by pain creates a facade that causes more sin and pain. Where this emotional refusal came from, and the techniques that we develop, maintain, and use to deny pain. Recorded on the 4th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, well, we've looked at our pain, and the reality is for most of us that, with regard to our pain, is that most of us are pretty desensitized to it, to be frank. You know, you're going to struggle really knowing what your pain is while you're so desensitized to it. And that's normal. It's normal to struggle to find your pain when there's so much on top of it. And so what we want to do now is look at what we've done on top of it, on top of this pain. And we want to see, you can see from our diagram here, and I know some of you can't see it easily from on the board, but you actually do. It is actually a diagram that you can print out on the website as a whole page. Some of you have it, I notice. What we're going to do now is look at the cause of our facade, what created our facade, and then what were the results of the facade as a result of that creation. So we're talking about now the creation of my facade. It's so good to know. It is good to know, isn't it? Yep. And one of the things the first group found out with this particular discussion was that they started to have a bit more compassion for themselves. You know, a lot of us are pretty hard on ourselves, and we have a huge amount of judgment of our facade, not understanding the terrible decisions that were made, some of them by others and some of them by us, that have actually caused our facade to come into being. So let's examine this question of the creation of my facade. The first thing we need to say is that I was taught to fear pain. If you were never taught to fear pain, you would never have created what's on top of it. How simple would that be? We just would feel it. It's the teaching that we need to fear pain that created everything that's on top of our pain. So this fearing of pain is a major issue for us. The fear of pain. The desire to just get pleasure and to avoid pain at all costs. If one of the single most important decisions that you are going to be faced with on your road to the recovery of your true self is going to be the decision to choose to feel pain rather than fear it. Just that one decision is going to change your life. But that one decision has to be made as a soul-based decision. It can't be made willpowering with your intellect through it. It actually has to be a choice made inside of your soul, a feeling-based choice. Just that one decision will absolutely change your life. So it's interesting, isn't it? One choice made to create our facade, one choice made and we have a large effect on the deconstruction of the facade. So let's have a look at this teaching, this really bad, false teaching, very destructive. It begins with our parents. And what our parents did was that they had a whole lot of internal pain inside of themselves. And so what they've decided to do with this pain is they decided to suppress it, to control it, to keep it under cover, keep it under wraps, to only go for pleasure and to avoid pain. In the that choice that they made, they were a living example to you. So this is the first thing. My parents' example was the first decision they made. So they modelled to you the behaviour. They modelled to you the terror that they felt inside of themselves, that pain should be avoided at all costs. And they modelled all of the actions that they took as a subsequent result to do that were all modelled to you. And you as a child didn't have a intellectual cognizance to be able to determine or differentiate between what they were doing and whether it was right or not. You didn't have a formulated intellect at that stage. You had no way of preventing yourself from being infected by this one terrible event. And when I say one terrible event, one terrible attitude that probably got infected by many thousands of events. So here we are, the child, and the poor unfortunate child. Unfortunately, you've got a soul, your soul, of which you're a half, of course, but you've got your soul, you've got your parents. And their attitude, their feelings were imposed upon this child, the soul of the child. And maybe what we need to do, instead of drawing it that large, we'll draw it as you were, a little baby. Spirit body, physical body, half of your soul. Your parents modelled to you by their feelings about pain. So their feelings about pain entered you. And remember, the child, because it does not have this whole, remember we discussed right at the beginning, this whole communication thing where we've got, you know, two people communicating. They've got heart, mind, language, mind, heart. Remember that cycle? Well, the child is used to doing this. The child was built to do that, in fact. But it has no way of determining what are valid or truthful emotions or not. It has no way of determining what God's truth is at that undeveloped stage. And so what happens is any of the parents' decisions and choices that were made from an emotional perspective got imposed upon the child. So because the parents chose to not release their pain and chose instead to create this whole castle of a facade, and these feelings about their fear of pain are now within the parents inside of their soul as an emotion, this emotion got transmitted to the child. And the reason why you're so terrified is because you have no idea where this emotion came from. You just absorb the emotion of terror without understanding where it came from. So now all of you are terrified about feeling emotion, feeling pain. Terrified, literally terrified. So that's number one. We need to understand that. We need to have compassion. You need to have compassion for yourself, that there's nothing that you could have done about that. It's only your parents who had control over it at that point. Dennis? We just have Dennis, thanks, Paige.
Is that why we strive so vehemently to understand our emotions?
Yes, a lot of what we see, a child by nature doesn't try to understand its emotions, it experiences its emotions before it even knows what they are. It's experiencing them. As adults, we try to understand because we're driven by this terror of them. We are terrified of emotions generally. And we, even many of your questions over the last 8 years have been driven by your terror of emotion. That's why when we get into a subject matter of some kind and we start discussing God's laws or God's feelings about this, and we start discussing wonderful things, will and other faith and other things like that, it always seems to revert back to a question and answer about emotions. And why is that? Because of this problem. Because you're terrified of actually feeling an emotion. And so it actually prevents me from sharing with you more of God's truth, because you're so terrified that all you can ask about is emotion. Does that make sense? Mm. And it causes a major problem to our learning and our capacity to feel, because we're actually so terrified of feeling that we're trying to prevent almost every feeling we have. And almost every question is driven by our desire to prevent the feeling of emotion. So we're driven, it's an addiction to prevent emotion. Yeah, it's a big problem. And if you examine, if you do go back over the last 8 or 9 years, since many of you have known us, the majority of your questions have been emotion-based questions. You look at our Q&A list on the FAQ list on our website. The biggest FAQ list is about emotions. We've got 7 or 8 sessions there already. The reason why is the majority are terrified of emotion, and they've got to ask all these questions about it. A child doesn't ask questions about emotions, it feels emotions. Adults ask questions about emotion before they feel them. Yep. So the parents modeled this behavior. Terrible thing to model, really. It causes a huge amount of terror inside of the child that it can't identify the source of. It can't identify the cause of it. It's very destructive. Now, the parents weren't happy with just doing that, though. They took an additional step, and that is they imposed upon the child in other words, they took measures, definite measures, to impose their terror of their own emotion upon the child, so the child was taught to be terrified of its own emotions, particularly when it's with the parent. Does that make sense? So now the parent is basically doing things like, and there's a lot of things that it's doing. It's using bribery and blackmail techniques to suppress the child's experience of emotion. It happens from the moment the child is born. The child starts crying. Most children start crying as soon as they're born, unfortunately. So they don't, one of my sons, Tristan, he entered the world with a bit of a smile on his face and he never cried. But most children are not like that, right? Most instantly begin crying. And the reason why is because there's already so much imposed emotion that occurred between the time of conception and the time of birth that the child already has quite a lot to cry about. But what does the parent do? there, bottle, boob, bottle, boob, whatever it is, the choice, to and dummy, to try to stop the grieving process that the child is already starting to naturally engage. The parent, through its actions, is already suppressing the child's emotion through its actions. And the feeling in the parent is that this emotion of the child is now harming me. I'm distressed by my child crying. And of course, the reason why you're distressed by your child crying is because you're distressed by your own tears you haven't felt yet. Right, so that's why you're distressed. But you're distressed by your child crying, and as a result of that, when the child cries, you feel distressed. You want to try to shut the child up. Now, many parents use what they call loving techniques to do that, which is nursing the child, feeding the child, and so forth. But still the child cries. You know, so the child's had a feed, you've wiped its bum and done all the necessary things to make it comfortable, and yet it's still crying. What happens to the parent now? The parent's now very distressed, because the parent has a desire to suppress that kind of emotion inside of itself. And so it suppresses it in the child. So that's what a normal parent does. And it gets worse from there. Many parents, by the time the child is 1 or 2 years of age, revert to physical violence to control the child's emotions. You know, the terrible twos, when the child starts rebelling against the parent's imposed emotional restrictions. What does the parent start doing now? It starts using bribery and threats to manipulate the behaviour of the child. Bribery in that, give it a lolly. Distract it with something nice so that it doesn't have to feel, so that I don't have to put up with whatever it is the child's feeling. Or we go into threats. You know, you'll be in your room, you can't come out until you deal with this. Or it gets worse from there, doesn't it? Even violence. We start smacking the child for its behaviour, right? Imposing further restrictions. And now, not only further restrictions, but the threat of violence, which is why many of you are so terrified of violence. It actually happened in your childhood, where people who supposedly love you and told you they loved you would frequently, or at least sometimes, revert to violence in order to control you. So is it no wonder you fear pain? Isn't it no wonder? Yeah. Sad, huh? There's so many things that happen in that place. If you go back to what you and observe what a normal parent does with their child, and what we classify as normal parental behaviour, normal loving parental behaviour, you'll see that it's all about suppression and conformity, bringing the child into a state where it conforms with the adult and with the adult's definition of what the child can allow itself to experience. And then there's some areas, of course, where the child has a fairly unrestricted allowance of its emotion. So, for example, when it starts to learn to walk, it's allowed to go through that process where it falls over flat on its face, has a big cry, and because it's had a big cry, it's released that pain. And so what does it do next? Gets up, starts trying to walk again, as if the pain never happened. And the reason why is because it hasn't happened for that child. It's now released that pain. And so that's why most of us learn to walk. If that never happened, most of us would still be probably crawling around on our hands and knees, terrified to get up because of the imposed restrictions from our parents. But the reality is that our parents love us walking because in the end it alleviates more of their responsibilities, number one. Number two, it also is a developmental sign, a positive sign that the child is growing. And the parents love that, love to see the developmental side. So they honour those feelings in the child. So now we've got the problem where some feelings are not allowed and other feelings are allowed. And now there sets in a whole series of confusions. How do I determine, if I haven't got an intellect and I'm only going by feelings, how do I determine which feelings are allowed and which feelings are not allowed? You know the way I determine it? By what my parent feels. So if my parents feel fear or attack or anger, they're the feelings I'm not allowed. And if my parents feel good, happy, satisfied, they're the feelings I'm allowed to have. So now my feelings, without me knowing, are being manipulated and controlled by my response to my parents' emotions. Man, it's no wonder we're so confused, is it not? It's all just messed up. Now we're so confused, we don't know about our own emotions. We certainly don't honour them. Instead, what we're now taught to do is to honour our parents' emotions. That's the emotions we honour. So now our parents' emotions become our yardstick for what we're allowed to feel. So damaging, isn't it? Now I can't feel what I feel unless my parent allows me to feel. And can you see how controlled that makes me? already. I'm already now controlled. I haven't developed my intellect to even know I'm being controlled, and yet I'm being controlled. I'm being controlled because I'm now focused on how to prevent my parents' pain and therefore my own. Now, I could go on and on about this because we can talk about this for weeks and still not fully understand the true effect of our parents' behaviour upon us as children. It's no wonder we have these. No wonder. It's no wonder that we then start to do a whole heap of things here because of this terror of feeling emotional pain. Right. So what's the next thing that happens? Well, I've been taught this from a very young age. I've been engaging this behaviour now for 6 or 7 years. Right from the time I was conceived, I had all this emotion in me, some of which I was allowed to feel, some of which I'm not. Right? And I have to learn to be selective about which one, and that will depend totally on what my environment feels about which one I'm allowed to feel and which one I am not. So now I'm in this state, aren't I, where I'm so in tune to my environment's feelings, and now I can't even feel my own feelings anymore. Does that make sense? So I'm now a child. I'm still a child. I still don't have any real formulated idea or concept of what's happened. But I have basically been soul washed. Instead of brain washed, I have been soul washed. I've been taught all of these things without myself having the capacity to determine whether it's right or wrong what I've been taught. And there I am. I'm just a little child still, not knowing or understanding what's happened, but now feeling the emotional imperative to only do things under agreement or rebellion against my parent, with my parent or against my parents' emotions. That's my only choice. I can only agree with or rebel. I can't do anything else, really. I can't have my own feelings and just feel them, except where my parents have allowed me to. Okay, so what did I do then? I'm now 6 or 7 years old. I've now got a formulated mind, formulated brain. I'm now starting to think for myself, be self-aware. I've been beginning, to learn how to develop my will, which started usually by the time I can walk. I'm starting to develop the use of my will. And now by the time I'm 6 or 7 years of age, my will is pretty well set now. But where's my will set to? My will is to avoid pain. My will is to, rather than avoid, I could use the word fear, pain. So now I'm starting to make choices and decisions. I've already been taught that feeling pain is a bad thing. It's a terrible thing. It's going to cause very bad problems in your family. And the problem with it is that your very survival depends upon you believing that. The very people who are actually helping you survive have actually imposed these restrictions. And you know that it is true that your very survival does depend upon you accepting these restrictions. Your very survival depends on it. Because you try confronting a parent when you're a 2, 3, 4, 5, 6-year-old child. Most parents revert to violence in order to restrict your behaviour. So your very survival depends upon it. It does. In a way, your fear of pain was essential for your own survival. Can you see that? Because if you hadn't feared pain, just like your parents fear pain and just like they taught you to fear pain, then you would have been in disagreement with your parents. This was a state I was in my first century life. I was in constant disagreement with my parents emotionally. As a result of that, I got quite a lot of punishment in comparison to the normal child because of the disagreement. Now, I survived it, but most of you possibly would not have if the same thing had happened to yourself, given the fact that many parents are very abusive. And this is why when we talk about emotions, most of you become so afraid that you feel your very survival is threatened when we start discussing emotions. Can you see? There's a link to all of these feelings that you have inside of yourself. So now what do I do? Well, you can see now that I've started to have a developed sense of my own will, it's going to be very, very difficult for me, isn't it, to actually work against my parents' quite set opinions and will until I've left home. Because while I'm in their environment, their imposition of their belief systems with regard to pain is essential for my own survival. So it's highly likely that from the age of where I've developed some intellect now, 7 years of age, right the way through to my late teenage years, it's highly likely that I will either accept or rebel against my parents' choices and restrictions. If I rebel, most of you are kicked out of home if you rebel. And if I accept, then I've said to have a lovely family. And so the majority of us will be tempted to accept rather than rebel. So from the age of my developmental cycle, if you like, from the time when I'm a young child to the time that I'm a teenager in my late teens, I have now accepted the status quo of the belief about pain, which is you must fear it. You must be terrified of it. This is how you survive. So there I am. I'm now 16, 17, 18 years of age, maybe leaving home. That's my belief. Now, can you see that it's highly unlikely, unless some awareness has come to me at some point in my future, it's highly unlikely that I will break that paradigm, isn't it? Because it's really set. I've had 18 years of it now. It's set inside of me as a belief system. The terror is valid, is what my belief system is. The terror of emotion, the terror of pain is valid. You must avoid it at all costs. Now, the child by nature does not avoid pain. It is taught to avoid pain. Taught through a process, a very destructive process. So when I talk to you about your parents' sin, many of you still don't understand the extent of it. And one reason why you don't is because you don't understand that actually if you're a parent, you've actually imposed probably the same restrictions on the next generation. So there's automatically a blindness to these restrictions. There's a blindness to the restrictions that have been imposed because we believe they're right. We believe it's what love is. We believe that love is terrified of pain. Love avoids pain at all costs. It's a global emotional refusal of pain. Did you get that? And now I personally decide to live my life that way. And until some awareness occurs, so, you know, where I actually understand that God's laws are trying to expose this particular problem that's in all humanity, until that develops, I'm going to live that way. And I might live that way 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years before I have a developing awareness that it's maybe not the way to live. The majority of people on this planet pass into the spirit world with that belief. Very few people actually deconstruct their belief on Earth. You can see why. Because society and the parental system is all supporting that belief. To fit into society without being attacked, and to fit into family without being attacked, you have to believe that. You have to believe that pain should be avoided at all costs. Can you start to have some compassion for yourselves about that? Lorraine, thanks.
On top of the global emotion of refusing pain, is there an additional Asian serenity on top?
What happens with different, shall we call them races of people on Earth, is different, of course. You know, so some races will have different additional problems with how they've been brought up. But what I'm suggesting here is that every single one of those things are all driven by this emotional avoidance of terror, every single one. Even the desire to maintain an outward facade of, oh, everything's fine, is actually driven by it. Yeah. When everything's not fine. And I've been saying to many of you for years that everything's not fine, and you're going, yes, it was, yes, it was. Because you have the same thing that I had, and that is the internal necessity for survival to believe what you currently believe. That's what drives it, the necessity for survival. So what do? I now fear, I now use my will, so now I'm using my will. At all costs. I don't care what it costs me anymore. I'm using my will. I've now developed a very strong fear-based will. And this is what I'm saying to you. You don't realize it yet. Most of you do not realize that most of the questions that you ask me are driven by this very strong fear-based will. When you get rid of this very strong fear-based will, you won't even ask those questions anymore. Most questions are driven by the strong fear-based will. You think you're being logical, but actually you're being driven by fear. You think it's logical. So, Patty, you'd like to...
So we have this strong fear-based will,
mm-hmm.
and basically what you taught us last session,
mm-hmm. in the will discussion
was that we have an option, free choice,
mm-hmm.
to develop or discover a love-based will.
Correct. So can you see straight away that there's going to have to be something that we have to do about this fear-based will, isn't there?
Yeah.
This fear-based will is our problem.
Yeah.
It's the major thing that causes us to develop all of this above this in this diagram. All of the facade and everything above is all driven by this one underlying factor of our will being driven by fear. So you can see that our will being driven by fear is something we're going to have to address. Now, how do you release an emotion of fear? How do you release it?
Feel it.
You have to experience it.
Yeah.
And most of us do not want to experience terror.
Right, because my fear-based will is absolutely saying that's the last thing I want to do.
Correct. Correct. The very last thing the fear-based is telling you, don't do that. Above all things, don't do that. And it's the very thing you have to do in order to change, you see. And this is where our problems are, here, not here. This is the result of this problem. This is the cause of our problem. The cause of our problem is this underlying desire to prevent the emotion of terror. It's driving everything we do. Yeah. Everything we do. Every question we ask, every decision we make is driven by the pain-pleasure motivation rather than by love and truth. And the only way to deconstruct it is the very way that this particular wheel says don't do, and that is to feel the terror, to feel this global emotion of terror that exists within me that I don't even know what it's about, because most of it entered me before I even had a formulated intellectual idea or concept about it. And so for most of you, all you feel is just terrified contemplating it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I thank you for the gift of introducing love-based will. I mean, I don't get it yet, but thank you.
Yeah, it's one of the most powerful things to understand.
Yeah.
It also should give you some level of compassion for yourself. Can you see?
Yeah.
See, every time I talk about your addictions, what I feel from you is, AJ's judging us again. You know, he's criticizing this again, and I know I have that. Can he just let off on that and so forth, right? That's a general feeling. Well, the feeling I actually have is compassion for your situation. And you know why? Because I can feel how it got created. It got created through a terrible sequence of events that have been applied to all humanity. And it's been going on for millennia, thousands of years. Thousands of years this has been happening. It's no wonder, isn't it, that it's set like, it feels like it's set in stone within us, does it not? This terror. And we have to feel it to release it. The very thing that the terror tells us not to do. Yeah. So we come down to Ivana and up to Mary at the back.
So can we choose to just start feeling that global emotional terror, or do we have to actually start deconstructing the stuff that we've put on top?
Yes, we need to understand why this gets created now because of this, and we need to understand that the more we engage this, the less opportunity we're going to have to feel that. That's the point of this. The point of what's above this fear, the facade, the point of the facade is to deny this fear.
Yeah, so if we don't want to learn about the facade, then we've got no chance.
Exactly.
Really, of getting anywhere.
But we need to understand that sooner or later, we're going to have to feel our terror.
Yeah.
Sooner or later. Sooner or later, that's the key. While that terror exists, I'm going to create sin. I'm going to always make decisions based upon how terrified I am rather than based upon love and truth. While that fear exists in me. While I'm so terrified of feeling pain, I am going to create sin. Guaranteed. And I need to understand that. Yep. I need to get that. Yep. And that, of course, triggers, if we could write down here, it triggers my addictions. So now I engage a whole series of addictions, which you can see on the diagram over here, is now in this area here. And then on top of that, I can engage other things like denial, even above that, in order to avoid the fact that this is happening. And it's all happening up here now. And my addictions are like vortexes of need, like that. When to use the word needy is like insufficient, isn't it? They're like screaming demands at me, aren't they? That is screaming at you, got to do this, got to do this, got to do this. And so off you go and do it, you know. And then you're, oh, boy, that wasn't very good. More pain. And but next time the situation comes up, I've got to do it, I've got to do it, I've got to do it. You know, you're back into the same vortex because the fear, the terror is driving everything. And this terror is so unformulated within you. and so childlike in its nature, in the way that it operates, that you're not even thinking before you're doing. And we have to deconstruct it somehow. Does that make sense? But before we get to deconstructing it, we need to understand it. We need to accept it. We need to understand it. We need to get it. We need to sort of understand what creates all of our problems. So now that we've done these things, I've used my will that way, what do I do now? I go then and use my will the same way as my parents use their will, and that is, so I'll just rub this out now, I now use my will to create a whole heap of methods. Or techniques. To avoid what? The primary problem. My global experience, my feeling that I'm terrified of pain, my feeling that I'm terrified of any emotion at all, unless I can guarantee the fact that it's pleasurable. So what are those techniques? You learnt about them in the first group, didn't you? So let's yell some of them out, shall we?
Denial.
Excuse. Lie. Minimize. Justify. Somebody said ignorance is a good one, yes, thanks. Ignore. Deny. Blame and punish both self and others, and judge both self and others, and so forth. We're great at creating techniques. In fact, unbeknown to ourselves, our soul, our pain, is screaming at us to create techniques. It's saying you must create them. Create them, create them. Deny this. Shift the blame there. Go away from that. Minimize that. Maneuver. Judge. Punish. Do whatever you can. Do whatever you can to avoid this feeling of this terror. And we're just running around in circles most of our lives, avoiding terror. That's what we're doing. In fact, we go from relationship to relationship generally avoiding terror, right? We go from place to other place avoiding terror. We move to avoid terror. Loneliness and other emotions, we can't feel them. We're terrified of feeling them. We must do something about them, you know? You go out in the bush and it feels dry and inhabitable, so you come to Noosa so that you can feel comfortable again. Because out in the bush, you know, there's all these emotions that come up that don't come up in Noosa. You can go down the street and go to a restaurant when you want to, and you can get all these comfort things done. And so you don't have to go sort of out in the bush where you're sitting there and all alone and nobody's coming to you and nobody's feeding your vortexes of addiction. And so you've got to do something about it, so you move. Even most of our decisions to move are driven by it. Even most of our decisions in relationships are driven by it. It's just sad, but it's the way we are. The terror drives the process. The addictions that we have, which are physical, emotional, and spiritual. We even have spiritual addictions. What I mean by that is we go, okay, I feel really bad that I don't have much sort of seeming control over my life now. I'm just driven by my addictions. Of course I have no control, but I'm thinking, oh, I've got to get some control. What I need to do is create a whole heap of belief systems about God and about the universe that help me have more control, or that help me give up control. Now, like one really favourite one that seems to be chosen with New Age people is, you know, you give up the whole idea that you need to worry about it. Now you go up and have your review up in the spirit world. Then you know everything. And then when you come back here, you're meant to know nothing. You're just meant to work on what you become aware of and things like that. It's just, they're all created just to satisfy addiction, to satisfy the refusal of our terror, of the feeling of terror regarding pain. And we create religious systems on this planet, you know, the Christian religious faith, the Muslim religious faith, Hindu religious faith, all the primary religious faiths have been created by fear of one kind or another. Our family operates on fear. You try doing something different to what the family wants you to do, you'll soon see what happens. They go ballistic generally. It's very rare to have a family who doesn't, unless that family has, and the families have a sort of what I would classify as a area of allowances. So he is normal for the family, and he is what little Johnny is able to go plus or minus beyond what is normal, and anything below that or above that is apparent. It's out of line. It's not in harmony. So when they're above that, what do? You get back down, right? And when you're below that, what do? Medicate you to get you back up again. You're not allowed to have a set of experiences that are beyond what the family or society defines as normal. You're just not. Okay, so there we are. And now it's self-imposed. We go, oh, I'm too high, What do I do about that? You know, let's go and take a suppressant of some kind. Oh, I'm too low. Every morning I get up, I feel too low. Coffee. Ah, I feel like I needed that to get myself back in the zone of what is average, what is normal, isn't it? Because I'm not allowed to go beyond those experiences. I don't even let myself go beyond those experiences anymore. So I've been crying for 1 hour. Oh, what a terrible nightmare. I'm going to have to do something, go to the doctor or something. I can't even tolerate the smallest of amount of emotion because I'm only allowed to operate within bounds of normal. So I'm using these techniques to support this refusal to feel the terror, this terror driving my techniques. Is it any wonder that this happens? Not really, is it? Can you see that it's a pretty normal circumstance, isn't it? And this is what I'm trying to get at with you, is that you need to have compassion for the sake that this is what's happened. You know, what I see many of you doing is judging, criticizing, blaming yourself or blaming others, punishing yourself or punishing someone else who tells you this is happening. It's just the way it is. We need to come to accept what's happening. To accept what's happening, we need to see what's being created. And what I see is the majority of you have not allowed yourself, no matter what, you know, if you look back over the years, I've given you discussion after discussion after discussion about all these different things that have been created. And most of you are still in complete denial that this is what's been created inside of you and the reason why. And most of you are in complete denial of this underlying terror. The terror of feeling pain. The feeling of terror of feeling pain is a feeling we will not allow ourselves to even feel or address, even acknowledge. The majority of us don't even acknowledge it's there. While we're madly running around, you know, like, you know, the mouse that's going around and around, going nowhere, feeding the addiction to try to get comfort and satisfaction, because the vortexes of all these other painful emotions are so big within me and I'm so afraid of feeling every one of them, I've got to get something, someone to satisfy one of them, all of them, all of them need to be satisfied somehow. So I've got all these vortexes going out and all these vortexes going in, and I've got to satisfy them all. So I do. Without even thinking about what I'm doing. And in fact, for the majority of us, we try to think about what we're doing, and we still do it this way anyway. And the reason why is because this. This terror of pain that exists inside of me and my refusal to feel the actual pain is driving the decisions of my facade. My facade is caused by two primary things: my refusal to feel pain and my terror, my refusal to feel terror as an emotion. Two things. If I could change those two things, no facade would ever be created. Interesting, huh? Yeah. Alex?
So would you say that humility is the most important of the four tools?
Well, I was asked exactly the same question in the first group, and my feeling is faith is the most important of the four tools. The reason why faith is because at the beginning you don't have humility, right? And somehow you've got to get from not having humility to having it. And that requires faith in God's goodness. It requires faith that everything will turn out fine. It requires faith that if you do the right thing by just relieving yourself of these two issues, that things will improve in your life. So faith is more important than humility because faith comes before it.
Yeah, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah, I forgot what was the second one.
That's all right. So let's talk about the importance of the four tools.
Can I ask it?
Yeah, fine.
But a lot of people release their pain without faith, don't they?
No. Most people have pain that they think they're releasing, but actually what they're doing is they're living in this area where their addictions are not satisfied. That's what you've been doing most of the time.
Yeah.
You've been having what you feel is pain, releasing emotions, but actually the emotions that you've been processing have been emotions based on addictions not getting met. They're not related to this pain, the actual result of the sin that was caused. So most people are up here, and this is why when it came to questioning about, you know, the pain, everyone asked a question about pain in the previous group, and I said, no, that's up here. And that's up here, and that's up here. Every answer was up here, not down here. Because we've just got this layer of terror, and we're just like terrified of even going there or understanding what's going on. Terrified. All right? We'll talk more about that as we go along in the group, Alex. Graham, you wanted to ask?
All of that stuff above pain, is that like much, much bigger? We've created something that is humongous.
Correct.
To avoid something which is not actually all that big.
Excellent observation. We talk about that in 2 days' time, you know, on the third day, how we've just created this monster in order to avoid something that's quite small.
Because I've felt that in my own experience, that it's like there's been this sequence of just putting layer and layer and layer upon things, and you lose contact with the original thing that you're afraid of.
Correct.
You're just afraid of the previous layer. And
correct.
And each layer you build gets bigger than the layer before it.
Correct.
And you lose sight that the original thing that you're starting with wasn't actually all that big.
Exactly. Exactly. Sad, isn't it? So in proportion, this pain compared to all this, much smaller, right? The real pain is much smaller. The pain you're in right now is much greater than any pain you're going to have to experience.
So if I can see that, why the heck can't I just go, well, why can't I feel the pain?
Because we need to understand what's going on inside of ourselves to do that. Remember, this is a construction of our own or assisted by other people. We need to deconstruct it. We need to understand how to deconstruct it. And the reason why we don't see things is every subsequent layer is there to prevent awareness of the previous layer. That's why we don't see. Every subsequent layer helps us be not aware of the layer below it. Does that make sense? Yeah. And it's very important to get that. This is what's going on. We're creating a layer, creating another layer. And really what we're doing is creating a castle, a mountain, out of a molehill. That's what we're doing. And that's what we're literally doing.
So and you just can't intellectually go, well, see all that. Yes, I've created this bloody great thing and all I need to feel is that little thing at the bottom.
Yeah.
But
you can't intellectually can't do it. You know why? It's really simple why. Because all of these are emotions. And you can't intellectually deconstruct an emotion. Many of you think you can, but you can't. To deconstruct an emotion requires the feeling of an emotion. And what is this all telling us? Don't feel emotion, is what it's telling us. So the very thing that will heal me is the very thing that I'm terrified of doing. Sad, eh? Yeah, it's real sad. So, Paige?
So, starting from the top, mm-hmm. to actually get down to the real pain, is there going to be a level of terror to kind of step back?
Yes, you can see from what I've diagrammed here, you can see this is going to be a critical stage in your progression, isn't it? Without going through this, you are going to be impelled to create facade. So you can deconstruct facade, which is an important part of what you need to do. You need to become aware and deconstruct facade. But a part of deconstructing the facade, you're never going to finish deconstructing facade, in fact, until you feel this. Does that make sense? Until you feel this terror, you're never going to deconstruct facade. You're always going to be, if you don't deconstruct this terror and fear by feeling it, you are always going to feel impelled to create another facade. Does that make sense? So what do? In that place, we create a facade for this group of people, facade for that group of people, facade for mummy and daddy, facade for my wife, facade for my children, a facade for the world, a facade for my workmates. Right? And you take away one facade, and most of the time, most of us will just generate another. Because the terror tells us that we must. And unless you're prepared to at some point feel this terror, which actually has other links to other issues inside of ourselves, which we'll see later in our, you know, in a few days' time, 3 or 4 days' time, unless you're prepared to deconstruct this terror, highly unlikely you're going to be successful in not in fully deconstructing a facade. Can you see that? Because the terror is driving it. It's the engine driving it. You see, many of you have thought maybe the pain is driving it. The pain is the current state of your soul condition. The terror, which is the refusal of feeling pain, is driving most of your unloving behavior. It's the thing driving it. The reality is you can have pain without actually being terrified of it. A child does that when it learns to walk. It falls over flat on its face. It cries because it had an injury that it feels the pain of. And what does it do straight away? I keep saying this to you. It gets up and it walks again. If it had not have released the pain, what would it probably do? Sit there and be terrified of getting up ever again. But because it's allowed to release the pain, there's no judgment of it falling over. The parent often nurses it falling over, you know, and lets the child experience the pain. The child experiences the pain, it's released. And the soul-based imperative of the child, it looks at all the adults around it and says, you all walk so I can. So it has faith that if it gets up and tries again, eventually it'll learn to walk. And it's faith, which is not yet an intellectual-based thing, is it? It's a soul-based thing, just from noticing its environment. This faith allows it to get up again and walk, and it overcomes any residual terror it might have felt, even, to to not engage that behavior. But as adults, we don't do that. Every single terror, every single fear, every single emotion that we've stored is all just stored there, and it has a definite impact upon our next decision, upon our next choice. And there we are, living in all of the things we need to live in order to suppress the terror of feeling pain. That's what we do. So, Laura?
When the baby's crying and it's getting the dummy put in its mouth, mm-hmm. and it learns that to avoid emotion at all cost because it triggers the parents.
Yeah, it's not the dummy being put in the child's mouth that causes it to feel that. It's the feeling from the parent that causes it to feel that.
Yeah. Right.
The dummy is just a physical action the parent takes right. to solidify its own underlying belief system. But the child first feels the parent's feelings and associates the parent's feelings, and then the dummy, and they put the dummy in the mouth. Now the parent's feelings are suppressed. So associates dummy in mouth means mummy and daddy less distressed.
Does that also create the child to feel the rejection that, like how we feel rejection with God? Like, is it also the child feels rejected because it's not allowed to feel? Is a rejection?
Well, no,
in there
it feels
as well?
The opposite. It feels accepted when it doesn't feel. Do you see? It feels accepted when it doesn't feel. See, this is the way you see society. Society accepts you being in a non-feeling state, in a non-honest state, in a non-true state, in a facade state. Society accepts you. Right? So there's your reward. Your reward is you get accepted if you're in a non-feeling state. If you're in a feeling state, you now get rejected. So there's not only the negative, you know, the stick, if you like, impelling you to do it, but there's the so-called or seeming positive reward, which is acceptance, approval, which is now driving your motivations and behavior. Both are driving your behavior. So you get approved of by family and approved of by society if you refuse. Sorry, I'm mucking up Eloise's diagram. If you refuse the terror as an emotion, if you refuse pain, if you get approved of. And if you choose, you'll find. You choose to feel pain, society will definitely instantly find you not to their liking. And most of us are terrified of that, because that usually means our survival is threatened, and most of us are terrified of not surviving. Now, I'm already 3 minutes over, so I've just got to watch what I do now, because there's a whole section that I've missed out, which I think we can summarise a bit about our choices creating more sin. You can see up here, you can see in this area here, now that I've got that feeling in me, that feeling is now driving everything, isn't it? It's like everything's being driven by that feeling. Pain, pleasure, right? I'm sorry, babe, I didn't get to you with your question. Yeah.
I was just going to ask you to say what feeling. We can't see the board.
Oh, sorry. The feeling of refusal to feel our terror, right? Everything is now driven by that feeling, right? Being driven by this feeling of the suppression of terror, not wanting to feel terror about emotion in particular, I'm now driven to engage my addictions. I'm driven to the pain-pleasure paradigm, the whole concept that life is just all about getting as much pleasure as you can in the shortest possible time while at the same time avoiding as much pain as you can. That's what I'm driven by. I'm not driven by love and truth anymore. So the possibility of me being my loving self has now been thrown out of the window for the possibility only of being my safe self. Mm. my safe self. I feel safe by avoiding my terror and avoiding my pain, and I'm only driven by safety. I'm only driven by the prevention of pain and the desire for, the incessant need for, in fact, pleasure, because I so badly need pleasure, because there's all these needy things sucking everything into me, and I badly need satisfaction of these particular things. And I'm frantically going in my addictions. Remember the addiction diagram that Mary did in 2014? You remember the cycle of addiction? And in this area, you just, you got to have what you got to have, right? Without, and you guys, think of this. If I don't address my terror and feel it, this global emotion, refusal of terror, if I don't address that, what chance have I got to actually finish up getting rid of my facade? None whatsoever, actually. And I've seen people go on for thousands of years like that. Thousands of years. Just being driven by the incessant demand of the addiction in order to cover over the terror that needs to eventually be felt, but which is being prevented from being felt by creating these techniques, including the technique of denial completely. We start in that place where we're in complete denial that it's even happening. Now, like you, many of you even currently are, I was in complete denial. Complete denial. And it was only when I allowed myself to feel this that my desire to deny got released. Because while you have that, this global refusal of terror, while you have the terror inside of you, you have a desire to deny. In fact, you feel an imperative. You feel a demand to deny. Anybody exposes anything in you and you're angry as a hatter about it, because they're triggering, they're poking your terror. Isn't it? It's like, poke me in my terror and you're going to get it. Right? And that's what we're like. We do everything we can to avoid it. Everything we can. And like I said, in that place we'll kill, we murder, we go to war. All of it's driven by that. War, murder, all driven. But then we work out that there's nice ways of avoiding terror and there's not so nice ways. And so what we do to convince ourselves that we're nice, I'm a nice person, is we feed the addictions of others so that they will feed our addictions. So we enter these codependent bartering systems. It's still the same motivation. Because you take away the codependent bartering system, all of a sudden, where do we? We're unhappy again. We're angry again. Somebody doesn't feed our addiction, what do? Bang, we're unhappy again. We're angry again. All an indication. They just triggered our terror of pain. Mm. Interesting, huh? Yeah. Important to know, huh? Very important. Very important to remember as well. Because initially you're going to need to remember it because you don't feel it, you know? You don't feel it. You think, you know, you feel in the beginning, you feel like terror, no, you know, it's not, and it's not even a thought. It's just terror, pew, you're gone. You know, you're like road runner. Ting, ting, you're like, it's gone, you know, it's like instant. And that's how it works. So we use our will to engage the frenzied cycle of addiction, knowing that this addiction will help us suppress the feeling of being terrified. All the while we wake up every morning badly needing a coffee, because we wake up every morning quite terrified and badly needing something to suppress it. And then, of course, it's just a short step from there, isn't it, to full-on addictions that are physical. Drugs, alcohol, whatever. You know, as much sex as you can get, whatever. Just all to stay in the pleasure as much as possible, or to avoid the pain, the terror, as much as possible. It's a natural... It's almost a natural decision, isn't it, really? To go for any addiction we can get. No matter what. And there's our facade. There's the, as Graham said, the great construction from the small seed. Small seed. Small seed. And for us, most of us, look at that, and that is like a monster. And for most of us, this is the suppression and the calming down of the monster, right? But from God's perspective, this is the monster, because that's the thing that creates more sin, and that's the thing that creates more pain, and that's the thing that continues the cycle of pain over and over and over again for subsequent generations. The refusal to feel these two things, the pain, the terror itself of pain and pain itself, causes all of our unloving behaviour. It drives our will to such an extent that we don't even think anymore. We can't even think anymore about what to do. We are driven totally by the driving force that comes from within our soul to avoid those two things. So hopefully from this discussion you've understood what's really going on for your facade. Now tomorrow we're going to talk more about accepting that state, what we're going to have to do to accept this state. Today, what we want to try to do is understand the state, understand how it got there, why it's there, understand what, you know, do it at this stage. Don't worry about doing anything about it. Just look at it, it's there. Do you know what I mean? See that it's there. Let yourself feel that it's there. Unless you feel it's there, you won't believe me. You won't. I can talk till I'm blue in the face. You won't believe me. Until you start feeling that that's there, you won't believe it's there. You won't. You'll tell yourself everything possible to avoid the fact that it's there. But if we're honest with ourselves, most of us know that we're just damn terrified of most things. And we've got no idea why. And there's a good reason why we've got no idea why. This terror entered us before we even had an idea of anything. We were taught to have it, just as our parents before us were taught to have it, and their parents before them were taught to have it. And we can change it, but we don't believe we can. So we live in it. My whole life dictated by avoidance of terror. Honestly, my life was just honestly, I thought it was going good. I did. I was getting sick every month without fail. I was always, you know, under pressure, feeling terrified. I'd wake up every morning in dread, every morning. I don't know about you, but I woke up every single morning of my life until I was 34 years of age in complete dread of what would happen that day. I would sit down the day before at night and write down what could happen that day and then look at what I could do to mitigate and avoid what might happen that day. I was like insane with it. I was insane with the avoidance of terror. Just insane. Man, it was just full on. And then as soon as I started to try to deconstruct it, man, everyone around me had a meltdown. Like, I didn't melt down, they did. While they were calling me crazy, stupid, whatever. Man, it's just full on. You'll find it. When you go through that terror, you'll find it. You'll see what's going on. The only person that's going to agree with you doing it is the person who's already done it. Good luck with finding one. Yeah. But there's not many on this planet yet. But we're all going to have to, the whole planet's going to have to go through it. The whole planet. If we want real change to happen on this planet, we have to go through it. Yeah. Okay. So hopefully after that discussion, you've understood the creation of your facade, how it came about, what it is, where it comes from, and the two primary driving forces to retain it. G'day. Well, let's have a 10-minute break, and we'll come back at 25 to... I'm about 10 minutes or 15 minutes over at the moment. If we come back at 25 to 4 for our final question and answer for today. My pleasure. Thanks, Amber.